The best fried chicken in Texas. Brody's Country Fried Chicken. Texas born, Texas raised. A chicken joint with 35 years of service to our community. Thanks to our loyal customers and social media followers. Come try the best gizzards in Texas, the best tenders in Texas, and the best chicken in Texas. Call us at 830-773-9189. 830-773-9189. Don't forget, we have curbside service and delivery by DoorDash. Or find us on Facebook, Rodeus Chicken. R-O-D-E-E-S Chicken. Like us on Facebook. Like us on Facebook.
The best fried chicken in Texas.
Rodeus Country Fried Chicken.
That middle interview.
Hey, what's up, guys? What's going on? Thank you for tuning in again one more time. Thank you for rocking out with us one more time. That middle interview podcast, all the way from the state of Texas, rocking out with you guys. And we got a special guest on this episode, Mr. Goran Edman of the band Headless. They got a couple albums out there, and they got a new single out there by the name of Woman in White. The band Headless, H-E-A-D-L-E-S-S. Mr. Goran Edman is well known for being the frontman vocalist for guitar legend Yngwie Malmsteen. He recorded two albums with Mr. Malmsteen, Eclipse and Fire and Ice. Those two albums amongst a bunch of singles, right? So you guys should check out Mr. Edman's work with Malmsteen. Very cool stuff. I'm a huge fan of those two albums, more than any other Malmsteen records, really. But that's just my opinion, my preference. So anyways, we talked to Mr. Edman all the way from Europe, and he spends time with us with our podcast. Thank you. Thank you to him. Thank you, Mr. Goran Edman. And to all the guys in Headless, keep rocking, man. And before we go on, let's check out this brand new single from Headless, The Woman in White.
Excellent the heaven when none can not be here. Heathens were the eyes. We could find no scar here on the inside. The hurt it gives us where the meanings are. It's like the distance on the look of death. Now the body less begun. Two worlds like ordinances.
Isn't that some rocking stuff? Some very cool rock and roll. And, well, I call it rock and roll. I call it hard rock. I call it metal. I really enjoyed that. And here is our conversation with Mr. Goran Edman of Headless and formerly of Mr. Yngwie Malmsteen's band. And here is our conversation with Mr. Edman. Enjoy. So let's start with the first question. A new single, Woman in White, new album, Square One, coming out later this year, right? Can you talk about this single and the album?
Well, we're all sitting in the pandemic situation.
Yeah.
Separating us, so I'm sitting here and doing my stuff and sending everything to them in Italy for being recorded and mixed and everything. So glad we got it all together and managed to create the album.
How is that coming along, the album?
I don't know. Some, I don't know. We have this American M Theory or whatever, so, audio label.
Oh, yes.
And, well, I hope it will go fine. But, I mean, the situation right now is difficult because you never know when you can, you know, go out playing or or do things live.
So how...
To promote it.
How is the pandemic going on in your part of the country? What's going on there?
Well, we've been here at the peak, but it seems now that it's slowly, you know, normalizing, but it's going very slowly, and it's still a critical situation, especially because the vaccine plan is a little bit behind, you know, the schedule. So it's probably 65 plus that has been, you know, had the vaccine, and now they're trying to, you know, get the vaccine to people in that are a little bit younger. They see the good effect, though, that people that don't have the vaccine, they really, that is efficient, it's protecting them, the elder generation. Well, I got it because I'm working with the demented people, so, you know.
How is
that's
the...
why I
I'm sorry, go ahead.
But, yeah, I have a job at the site, you know, as an assistant nurse. So.
Oh, wow. Cool.
I was first in line to get the vaccine in March, February. So.
Oh, wow. What a cool job.
I can feel safe.
Right?
That's one of the few privileges of working with, you know, nursing people. It's a hard work, but somebody has to do it.
Wow, that's awesome. That's a... You're on the front lines.
Far from rock and roll scene.
Right. You're on
the front. You see, you know, musicians as demented people too, in a way, because everyone is so absent-minded and full of themselves. So they forget about the outside world. They get lost in their egos.
Right. That's so cool. You're in the front lines. That's very cool. Awesome.
Yeah.
My question is, how many tracks can fans expect on the... On this Headless album?
It's 10 tracks.
10 tracks?
Yeah.
Very, very cool. I'm sorry, go ahead.
I'm so confused all the time. Maybe it's 9, but...
It could be.
Normally it's 10. But it could be instrumental parts too. I think it's an instrumental song too, isn't it? But I'm just working with my stuff, so I don't have the full perspective of the album.
Right.
I'm always the confused one, you know. But I know I'm on the planet Earth. so it's good.
You're on the right planet.
Yeah.
Earth. Very cool. Very cool music video. I saw the woman in white video directed by Dimitar Stemenov. Is that the right way to pronounce it? He worked with Sabaton and Motorhead apparently. And did you get to meet this director?
No, I never met him, unfortunately. Just sitting here. All I see is cats and buses.
That's real cool that you guys got a record deal with the record company, and the people that already know about Headless, that's cool. And the ones that don't know about Headless, where can you give the fans the website, or where can fans find more stuff from Headless?
Oh, I guess that's their home website. But I don't know so much about the promotion part. So I mean, it's Walter and Dario is mostly responsible for.
Okay.
For those kind of informations, and I'm more like involved in the vocal parts and arrangements.
Yeah.
And choir arrangements and everything.
Exactly. Yeah. I'll go ahead and paste I'll put the link on the video and the platform. You know, the Spotify. And I'll go ahead and put the. Your website and all that for you guys.
It's all available out there now, so on all these platforms and YouTube, the videos. And
so
I hope the album will be released. I don't know if it's going to be to the summer or in the autumn.
Awesome.
Later this year is all I've heard so far.
Well, I heard I like the Woman in White video. I like that. That's real cool jam. Who wrote that song? Is it the whole band as a unit, or was it just one person?
I think it's Walter and Dario together who's writing the music, and then they're sending the material to me without any melody, you know, so my own ideas.
Oh, wow.
And then they have their own ideas, but they're trying to see if my ideas will be better than theirs, and if they want to change something, they suddenly, you know, but it sometimes becomes a combination of my ideas and their ideas.
Sort
of compromise with the best of two worlds.
You're right. Well, it come out real good. So good job with that song right there. Very awesome stuff. And
thank you.
So let's talk about you. You're a great singer. You're known for being with Yngwie Malmsteen. We'll get to that part in a little bit. At what age did you know you could sing? How old were you when you knew you had a voice?
Well, I was a little bit old for starting to being a musician. Most have this kind of, you know, ambition or vision when they are like teenagers, that they want to be, you know, want to start to learn playing an instrument or something and have an ambition to do something with it. But it was more randomly that I started singing when I was around 20 years old. So.
Oh, wow.
And it was more like a friend that heard me sing on a toilet drunk. I think I was singing opera or something. Solo me.
Oh, wow.
And they're like, wow, you got a great voice. We have a little garage band, and our singer is going to quit. So maybe you can. You want to make an audition? So let me sing. I have to learn to sing two songs. One was Panacea with Rush, and the other one was a Status Quo song, but I don't remember which one of their songs it was now.
Cool. What a story. You were very cool.
It was these two songs, basically, and that I performed. And they liked what they heard, so that's how it all started, I guess.
Very cool.
If they hadn't asked, maybe I wouldn't have, you know, been starting to sing. it's all like, you know, random, what's happening in life.
Really?
Like a leaf in the wind. Wherever it blows.
Right. That's cool. I've read a little bit about your bio, and is the band Stratosphere still active?
Stratosphere. That was a long time ago. No, I haven't heard from him anymore.
Okay.
So there was a Danish guy who made all this, put the songs together and sent them over to me.
Cool.
But nothing happened with it, so I guess it just died.
Yeah.
As many other projects, you know.
good stuff. So I guess Stratosphere is inactive. It doesn't exist anymore. Okay.
No, I haven't heard anything from him. But that could be that he's still, you know.
You recorded
songs.
You recorded two of my favorite Malmsteen records, Eclipse and Fire and Ice. How did you get the Malmsteen gig? How did you get in contact with him?
Well, that was also one day his manager just called me and asked me if I was interested in making an audition and going to Miami to meet Yngwie and hang with him for a couple of days and probably sing a tune on the album that he was going to record. He had a few songs already recorded. Save Our Love was one of them, and that was the song he made me sing in the middle of the night after too many drinks of vodka.
Oh, wow,
that
really?
That was my audition, and I love it. Then I have to go back and pack my bag. Yeah.
Awesome song.
But actually, I think it was through the John Norum album that he, you know, got to know my voice, because he listened. They knew each other very well, John Norum and Yngwie, so...
Uh-huh.
They listened at their materials, and he played his Total Control album for England. And I was singing this song, Black on the Streets, the Vinnie Vincent cover that he made on that album. And probably that is a song that he heard.
That's right, yeah.
That I had a high range and everything, so he needed to sing with a high range.
Yeah, for sure. Most of Malmsteen's vocalists have that range, huh?
Yeah. Yeah, Mark, balls have it naturally, but I have to squeeze my balls to get that high.
Yeah, it's a...
So it was a little bit difficult to, you know, the live parts was a little bit, you know, every time I had to really wear myself out. But
yeah.
But fortunately, you know, my voice lasted, you know, through the tours.
Yeah, well, that's awesome that you were a part of that. That organization, the Malmsteen people. When you guys were writing those albums, Eclipse and Fire and Ice, were you a part of the songwriting process, or did Malmsteen already have everything laid on the table, basically?
No, not on Eclipse, especially. I think there was a lot of songs where there was no lyric and there was no melody, so I had the chance to make my own melodies and the only thing that he had probably was the title or anything, like, you know, this song is going to be called Judas, and it's about the music industry.
Yeah.
I'm throwing pearls to the swine. Okay, so write something about that. I see what I can put together. and then there were other titles that I made up myself. Even Making Love was one of them. Bedroom Eyes was mostly the title too that he had. This is going to be called Bedroom Eyes, so write something about Bedroom Eyes.
Right. Did a good job. Very,
but
very.
The melody there was more or less mine than on Bedroom, what, Making Love and Bedroom Eyes and Fault Line.
Oh, yeah.
Too. But he didn't like Eclipse in for the reason that it was like overproduced, he thought, like too many choirs and arrangements, and it's difficult to perform live. So he wanted to have the second album more like basic, like raw and more live sounding.
Yeah, they're both.
I remember.
Fire and Ice is a little bit different than Eclipse, and they're both good to me. They're awesome. My favorite records from Malmsteen,
yeah,
from
yeah.
Out of the whole. That's they got real good songs in there, you know. Dragonfly, they got there's a bunch of good stuff. How Many Miles to Babylon, you know, awesome stuff. Very,
yeah.
Very good stuff. Lyrics there, you did lyrics there too?
Yeah, some parts, I think the verses. Not How Many Miles to Babylon was his, that chorus line, but I think the verses I did, the melody too, and the lyric. Cry No More, I did.
Cry
that
No More?
My own lyric.
Oh yeah, all those
maybe
are great
have the titles.
That
was actually one of the better videos we made that had a meaning too, like, you know, with political meaning. Maybe that's why they didn't, the record company decided not to release it, because Yngwie Malmsteen and political messages was not like, didn't belong to each other.
Did you ever get compared to the former vocalists, like Jeff Scott Soto or Bowles or Lynn Turner?
Well, of course, there was always people, you know, especially when you played live, you know, that they had, you could see in their faces that they had another favorite singer.
Really?
Some even gave me the finger.
Really?
Staring at me like, but in the end, there was always the people that you started to look at when you were singing terrified.
Wow, that's some people can be cruel
about that. Gave me a smile.
Right?
In the end. But of course, it's difficult when you replace a lot of other singers. They're all great. But we all have a different style, so.
Oh, yeah, they're all good. Yeah. You have a good, great style.
But the only one I met was Jeff Scott Soto, so yeah, he was a very, very friendly person.
Oh, yeah, we had him on the podcast last year. He's a very, very friendly guy.
Yeah.
Very cool guy, yeah.
Yeah, I liked him a lot as a person.
What an honor in working with Malmsteen, of course. What happened at the end? Why was there a split there? Did you leave, or?
I think we got fed up on each other. Yngwie was difficult sometimes.
Okay.
My tolerance was also very low, so I was starting to complaining and having a bad attitude. And I think Yngwie noticed that also, that I didn't have the inspiration for what I was doing anymore.
Yeah.
I think the divorce that I went through also made it very, you know, difficult for me.
Okay.
During the Fire and Ice tour, so it was naturally that we split up. I think.
Yeah.
I felt it coming, definitely, because after the last gig we had in Seattle. Stage clothes at the gig. I remember I gave away the jacket to someone to a friend. Oh, I love your jacket. Oh, take it.
Wow.
So I think I had it, you know, I felt it coming.
Yeah.
Anyway, we had a serious talk that day too, and during after the sound check, because I was starting to have a cold, and so for a change I didn't go to the stage when I was about to do the sound check. I was sitting with our mixing guy, and I asked him, "Do you really need me to sing?" No, I know your settings on the table, so I don't need you to be there. You know, just relax.
Yeah.
But then the Yngwie suddenly stopped, and he went to the microphone. He said, "I want the fucking singer at the fucking stage right fucking now." And he started to play Bedroom Eyes, the intro, and it went on forever and forever and forever till I, you know, reached the stage.
Yeah.
It was a very long intro. And when I came to get each other for a while, I didn't sing, and he just played the intro and were looking at me, and then he took the pick and, you know, sticked it to my forehead.
Really?
And I guess that was a sign that sing.
Yeah.
I think you should sing now.
that's the cue. I've heard some stories that Malmsteen is difficult to work with from different people.
Yeah.
It's just another.
He had his good moments and bad moments. I think the best moments are when you're just hanging with him and there's nothing going on. But when you're working with him, it can become kind of tense sometimes.
Who are your influences? Who are your heroes?
Well, I guess you're getting influenced by a lot of people, but some of them are not so, you know, obvious, because you can't hear it in the way you sing. I mean, I grew up with a progressive rock, so my heroes were like Peter Gabriel or Frank Zappa and that kind of music. But as singers, they can, you know, be a sort of influence. Could be Paul Rodgers, maybe.
All right, there you go.
A little bit. That style, the blues rock style.
Oh, yeah. Great singer, right there.
The high range singers.
Yeah.
But I always loved, you know, Journey and and these kind of bands, Kansas, Steve Walsh.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Nice.
I love this voice from a lot.
Oh yeah, good, great singers right there. What is your favorite gig, and give us your worst gig? Favorite and worst gig. Worst gig and favorite gig.
The favorite gig was probably in Indonesia. Because everything was so exotic and everything around this trip over there, like it was a big stadium.
Yeah.
And there were like guards with machine guns shooting. Everything was very absurd. And then the monsoon rain came, so we have to, you know, after four songs, we had to stop.
Really?
And escape. They had to smuggle us out because they thought the audience, you know, we were going to have a riot.
Wow.
Search for the money they paid. everything about Indonesia was the best part of the whole Eclipse tour, I think, because we celebrated Yngwie's birthday there on a little in the Pacifics, and it was very memorable.
Cool. Wow.
Probably Long Island, somewhere in close to New York, because we started like we ever here, you know, a cappella liar.
Yeah.
We started to play, and then the electricity went out.
Oh wow!
Three times in a row. So it was getting very tense, and Yngwie was starting to drink and got really drunk before, you know, we finally solved the problem. It was a terrible, you know, concert. He was just trying. He was freaking out more or less.
Wow!
So it was impossible to be on the stage because he was running around. And I also got my microphone stand in front of the monitors, and then he kicked it down. And when it came up, it was bent and ruined.
Hey, wow.
And so I hated that gig. That was really, you know, I was almost starting to cry on stage.
Hey, wow.
I was so upset.
Wow, that's horrible. Wow. So
there was a girl standing in front of the monitors, and she saw what I was going through mentally, so she gave me like a kiss and a thumbs up or something like that, and that really saved me from, you know, breaking down.
Wow, that's cool. What a story. So what?
Difficult to be around.
Yeah, that's another story right there. Wow. So what do you listen to nowadays? What's on your playlist? What bands do you listen to?
I don't listen so much anymore. I have to get back to that, you know, the hunger for discovering music.
Yeah.
I'm listening to birds because I'm living at the countryside, so there's a lot of, especially now in the spring and everything, there's a lot of birds. I like that soundtrack, the silence.
There you go. That's a good soundtrack.
You're sitting all the time in the studio with headphones like 8 hours or like 3-4 hours in a row, and then you just want to rest your ears. So.
Wow, cool.
But I guess Steven Wilson, I guess, that kind of music. We're still in the progressive era, so.
Cool. So what can fans expect next from yourself? What are you brewing? What's coming up next for yourself and Headless or any other projects?
Well, I guess it's Headless now. Las Vegas is working on a new album because they already have the material on. I think it will be the fourth album with Crossfade. It's a kind of West Coast oriented music, but very well produced and recorded in a very nice studio. And I don't know, it seems like Jonas Reingold, the Car Mechanic, I made 5 albums with them, so he sent me some new material, so I guess that indicates that he wants me to sing on the next album. But
okay, cool.
He's out with Steve Hackett now, so he's been... before the pandemic, he was out playing with Steve Hackett, so...
Okay.
The icons of rock. The progressive rock, so...
Cool.
I guess we'll see what happens with that project.
Any other projects you want to talk about?
No, those are the ones. Spirit.
Uh-huh.
It's the name of the band. It's blues rock from the 70s, more or less.
Spirit?
That was released for... recently. The name of the album is Fresh from the Can. It's Beans. It's not going to be so fresh after a couple of hours.
Right?
you're on the fire cap. And
right?
but it's blues rock oriented music. Cool. So it's totally different from Headless.
Very different, okay. I'll go ahead and check it out. We'll, to all the listeners, you guys can check it out, you know. Would you like to send a message to the Headless fans and your fans listening to this podcast?
Yeah. Well, I hope to see you out there. Goes away.
Right.
Get the vaccine. Make it happen. That's the only way we can change this situation. Yeah, that's a message.
Cool. Well, we thank you for making time, Goran. Thank you for making time for our podcast. And we hope to see you on tour very soon. And can't wait to hear the Headless album.
Yes, it was an honor. The pleasure and honor is on my side.
Oh, no, my pleasure. We're all big fans here of your work with Malmsteen and all your work. We're all fans of yours. Thank you for making good rock. Thank you for all that.
Okay. Thank you very much.
A true honor of mine being a fan, man. I was a fan of I'm still a fan, but when I was a kid, I was a big, huge fan of Eclipse and Fire and Ice. Those two, specifically those two Malmsteen records, I was a big, big fan, and I'm still a big fan. Track one to the last track, all the tracks on those two cassettes, albums or whatever you want to call them, they're just all badass. And it's just a pleasure of mine to talk to this legend right there, man. He deserves more attention, man, you know. And there you heard some stories, some good stories and some bad stories with Mr. Malmsteen. So anyways, we hope you enjoyed it. Don't forget to subscribe to our YouTube channel and ring the bell. And follow us on social media. You know what to do. Thank you, guys. And don't forget to share and spread the word, man. That Metal Interview Podcast. Don't forget to rock out with our rock show, jrocksmetalzone.com. And don't forget to keep it metal.
That Metal Interview.